Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. There are two purposes of this exquisite type lecture. Number one, I want to tell you that after studying the course of material science one, I theoretically explained to you many things, but you didn't see them in practice, that how people do all these things. The second thing is that we are preparing this video for the University of Peshawar and tell the people around the country and globally that what sort of facilities do we have in this lake, right? So when you are making a material, the first thing is to use the balance. This balance, if you look into it, it is four zeros after the decimal point. Four zeros after the decimal point means that it can resolve up to 0.1 milligram, right? But 0.1 milligram is also a lot in material science. 0.1 milligram is not the ordinary 0.1 milligram which you think in ordinary weighing. 0.1 milligram can change the properties of a material from one type into another. And stoichiometry, when you are making stoichiometric composition, for example, you are making BATIO3, then it must be BATIO3. If one atom is missing or one atom is excess, then it is a defect inside the material. So when you are weighing materials, the initial raw materials, the first thing a researcher should do is to look into the safety data of that material, whether it is touchable or not with fingers. So you must use gloves, right? Secondly, if it is hazardous, are the dust coming from it, are the fumes coming from it, you must have a mask. You must have goggles to protect your eyes so that no hazard come to you from the material you are using. In standard laboratories throughout the world, the first thing is safety. And there are many diseases associated with their safety. For example, in the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory, there has been written a book about the martyrs of radiations. And many people died because of exposure to radiation. But after 50 years, after 30 years, after 20 years, so as a student, you are smart, you are young, and you don't feel any hazardous effect of the material. But when your age goes up and that contamination or inhalation of those dust and powders goes to your lungs, then your illnesses start. So you must be very, very careful about using the materials. You look into the safety data and the hazards effects of each material you are using. And in standard laboratories, it is called Kasch form evaluation. Kasch form evaluation, which is all the precautions to be used. You must know what sort of hazardous effects this particular material has. Secondly, how to dispose it. If you are using this platinum, the aluminum foil for weighing the material, then where to dispose it? Should it go into somewhere which it can harm other people, or it should be safe? If you are throwing it in water, is it allowed to flow this in water and wash it in the ordinary sink, or it is hazardous? From your university, Islamic College Peshawar, you know the name. He was captain of Pakistan hockey team. He died for cancer, and the cancer started from his leg. And when I asked people, he was my class fellow, they say that there is a doubt, we don't know. But he used to be practicing hockey at the backside grounds of the Irnam Hospital, and where the drainage system was going there. right? My own supervisor, he died of cancer. And as I remember, europium and cobalt, strontium, sources used to be placed near his desk. And from that leg, the cancer started. So don't take these things light. Even the sane has many diseases, and it should not be inhaled. Once you have done that, the next step is on the purities. Whether you need 99% pure material, whether you need 99.99% pure material, or 99.999, depends upon the sensitivity of the compound you are making, right? Once that is being done and you have ordered the material, they have come here, you are using this balance to take stoichiometric proportions. That if you are making barium titanate, how much barium carbonate is needed and how much titanium oxide is needed. You weigh them carefully and you use aluminum foil or you will use white paper, very clean paper. I put the clean paper here, zero the balance, right? Zero the balance with the paper, in. Then you put slightly the material in a careful manner so that you weigh, for example, you need 5.358 grams of titanium oxide. You need 10.5345 grams of barium carbonate. And you combine that, then you are watching this, it is a mill, horizontal ball mill. It is running. It is a disposable polyethylene mill jar, right? Disposable polyethylene mill jar. You must know the material of the jar. For example, if it is a porcelain jar, then there is chances that porcelain is aluminum silicate, alkali aluminum silicate. Right? Then if the material grinds inside it, it touches the surface and grind it inside it, then there is possibility that there may be some contamination from the body of the jar. So if you see, for example, you are making barium titanate and you find aluminum silicate peaks in the XRD, this means your mill jar contaminated your material. So it is not good. That is why people started to mill materials in the disposable mill jars. It is called mill jar. This rubber band around it has been tied because it is slippery. It will not rotate with these rods if those rubber bands are not there. Inside these are milling media. Milling media are something like small balls which are very, very hard, and the particles of the powder under process, they go in between those balls, and fine particles are made from the larger particles, larger grains of the material, right? So if you need, for example, you are making barium titanate and you need about 1 micron particle size in your final powder, then you need to grind it for up to 24 hours, right? When it is grinded inside it, the next thing is, here you call it mixed milling. You mixed mill the batch you prepared by weighing different weights of barium carbonate and titanium. It is called, when you mix it, it is called batch, B-A-T-C-H. When you grinded it, you mixed it as well as you decreased the particle size of the powder. Two jobs, right? Remember, it is doing nothing except that. Once you have done this, then you put a sieve and pour this slurry rubber on the sieve into the glass, clean glass beaker. Usually, when I use even a brand new vehicle, I wash it with acetone so that no dust particle or anything is there. Once you have poured it, then spray acetone on the top. So all the balls are left in the sieve and the slurry, the fluid slurry of powder goes down the beaker. Then we have a furnace there at that corner. It is called the drying furnace. And you put the material there at 90 degrees Celsius for 12 hours, 24 hours, so that the water content completely evaporates. Remember, you have three things here in this milk jar. The powder which you are milling, the balls which is the grinding media, and third is the acetone or distilled water, depending on the type of material. So if it is acetone or propanol type things, they evaporate at 90 degrees. If it is water, then you need to go a bit higher, right? 95 degrees, but not very high temperature, because if you boil those powder, that slurry, what will happen? It will splash around on the beaker and your composition will not be stoichiometric. You will lose material. Secondly, your composition will not be stoichiometric. When it's boiling, obviously the lighter particle will come to the top and the heavier will go down. So you will lose the lighter particle. So if the lighter particle belongs to barium carbonate or they correspond to titanium oxide, you will lose that proportion. In any case, your composition will be disrupted, right? So always keep the minimum temperature so that no splashing occurs. This splashing contaminates the furnace as well. So when other students use that furnace and your material is splashed around there, then you are contaminating other materials as well. It is not good for the furnace as well, because we need clean furnaces. Internationally, people have clean, dirty and filthy, three categories of furnaces. The materials which has no problem in any case, they are called clean materials, and their compositions are processed in those furnaces. If a material has some volatile content, then depending on the hazardous nature of the volatile content, the less hazardous are processed in dirty furnaces, and the worst hazardous materials are processed in the filthy furnaces. So whenever you go to standard lab and you see three type of furnaces, clean, dirty, filthy, they are for those purposes. And you must know before using the lab that whether your material should be processed in filthy, dirty or whatever furnace it is. So when you dry it, then you again grind it a little bit with pistol and mortar. Pistol lang rin, mortar garge. You put it and grind it, right? Then you sieve it. Sieving is important in order to remove any ear hair, H-A-I-R, or anything which is abnormal in that material. So when you sieve it, it does that thing. Secondly, it deagglomerates the powder. The gitiya ke do ne bachki. Asi fu gitiya ki gitiya der fine powder hi hai. No chiti sieve ke no dae do gitiya ke do ne bachki. When you have done this,